Cheeky Sport on Rinse.
All right, you are now tuning to Rinse FM, and this is Cheeky Sport. You have myself, Big J.
Cheeky Sport, Ack.
Jike.
Yeah, Jike, your buzz. And we've got a special guest in the building. We've got a super striker. A Prem legend. We got Mala Darabin in the studio.
Very reserved clap from me.
It's kind of mad because obviously I wanted to get you on the show. I thought I'd missed the opportunity. I thought, you know what, man, missed it. Man, let the boat slip. But luckily, I saw you again. And thank you so much for coming today, bro.
Well, did he pester you proper? Was he just like, please, come on? Please, I'll do anything. That's on his knees and that. He's on his knees and that. Please.
You see, Jack, he loves to chat rubbish.
But you just call me butters. You see your big belly on fucking Instagram.
Oh, no.
Hey, we're going to show Darren after the show.
He's going to come up in the corner now.
Don't be trying to do them cues. Obviously, we're in the studio right now. How you feel? We're just coming back off this, Lukaku freestyle that we've all been watching.
What was it?
It was kind of wicked in the streets. I was kind of...
Fire in the tooth.
Hey.
Fire in the Tims, mate. Fire in the Timberland.
Ah, bro, it's a bit peak, yeah? Obviously, nah, I wanted to ask, I'm a bit annoyed, innit, as a United fan, the fact that Puma allowed this freestyle to go. I don't care if it was man's bars
it's
or not.
I think it's deep.
It's
it shows a human side to him, bro.
Why do you guys like this human side thing so much?
Because people should be able to express that side.
If it's a Puma advert, why can't he just kick ball like they used to do back in the day? Do a couple kick ups.
Yeah, because if
pushing.
He did that, he wouldn't be able to edit out all the misses.
I thought you were about to say. You see, I knew you were about to say.
You know what, Darren? Can I ask you a question on this? Yeah. Can I look? Obviously, everyone notices the correlation of when teams and players play badly or when they lose games, they don't post and they don't do stuff like this. Yeah. But if they're playing well, it's all funny.
Yeah, this what I'm saying is that the Lukaku freestyle, if he was playing well, scoring goals, United were flying, no one would say nothing.
No one would say nothing.
People would like it, but because obviously he's not playing well, he's not scoring, United aren't doing well, he's giving an excuse to everyone to jump on it.
Bro, you know the joke's already. Raw, his flow's like how he plays.
His
delivery's like his touch.
Even if he was scoring 30 goals this season, those bars were so... everything was whack. Like, the bars were carbon.
No, but it don't matter, fam. I'll re-upload it with bare snowfall emojis and that, some fire emojis. Man's on it.
Now I'm going to defend Lukaku and say the beat was off still.
It's the beat. Did you guys see Lingard's little response as well?
Yeah, big up Lingard sending that through. The care package.
Don't get gassed up.
That's my dog, Jesse. He doesn't know me, but
I got to ask you though, Daniel. Obviously, it's a lot different now. You see players bantering like this online.
Yeah.
To the world wide web. Like, everyone knows.
Yeah.
Like, it's a lot different from obviously when you first came into the Premier League and stuff like that. Yes, like, what do you think about it? Is it kind of like something you're a bit... Are you not saying that you're against it, but like, how do you feel about it?
I'm not against it at all. I think it's a good idea. It's a way for obviously the fans and the players to interact.
Yeah.
Obviously they can get closer to the players. Obviously when I was first coming through, it was impossible to obviously there was only, I think, MySpace, I think
it was Bebo.
What are you saying? If the gaffer found the MySpace, you know, a couple of tracks on there and that.
Man had to put advert and yellow pages and that.
Yeah. Darren, was you on MySpace? Yeah.
Gaffer found the freestyle. Now, let's go ask.
Oh, yeah. Darren's got hella freestyles on
if
there.
If you guys don't know, even Daniel Sturridge, we all know Daniel Sturridge likes to be in the studio a bit as well,
And he got a record label.
Yeah. And we know, Ferdy's had a record label as well, before he sold it.
Ferdy coming fast?
Come on, bro.
I'll go anywhere.
Hey, look, the lifestyle's a bit similar, innit? You know, the sports... Be honest, did you ever want to go in the booth and drop some of these fire bars for them?
Do you know what? Like, back in the day growing up, obviously I listened to old school garage grime, but I knew I was never good at it. So obviously you rap other people's lyrics. Like, when I was growing up, it was about Dizzy, D-Double, Nasty Crew, people like that. So you'd rap it, but I wouldn't never get in the booth and do my own bars.
You guys ever at training? You guys never did some training freestyles and that? I know certain men were on that. a little training freestyle. Nothing like that, no. Were there a few players? Be honest.
A little bit, but it was more, as I said, doing Heartless Crew lines, and I might do a
Pleasure Crew line. Okay. No, that's cool.
Would you go harder than Lukaku, though?
Would
you go harder than Lukaku?
Hey, so Darren,
I'll definitely put my money on Darren Bay.
Going back on this, so do you think, he done it to get the fans back on his side, or do you think he just done it for banter?
Because bro, it was an advert.
Yeah,
I think that's annoying.
Yeah, but he would have to. Yeah, he would have to agree to it, though, no?
No, and do you know what is mad? It's because he did it with some Belgian rapper. kind of thing. So it was like a Belgian rapper kind of.
Because you know what don't make sense? Someone should have watched that and thought, nah, do it again.
Yeah, no, that's what I'm saying.
Take, stop. No, stop. Yeah, yeah,
yeah, yeah. It's a sign off.
You know what it is? All these
the way the hood's up. The hood's up over. Look at
the thing is, all these big companies, man.
DC studio, you know.
All these big companies have no idea. So they go, oh my God, yeah, that's really good. Yeah, oh my, wow, yeah. Oh wow, Rumble, that's really good.
Fantastic, sign it off.
Like all them apprentice dons, bro.
What I thought though was that, could Lukaku not watch it back himself and go, nah.
Yeah,
that ain't it, yo.
I'm from the mean streets. You know, I come in like my family. Brother, even though
he sounded mad on that, but
obviously, yeah, big up Belgium, like big up Lukaku and your, like, obviously all your accents, do you know what I mean? There's a bit American in there.
Just take the jeans off, mate. Just take them off.
Before
we get on to that, did you see that interview with Poet and Vooj with Ashley Young and Rashford? So obviously it was like a True Religion thing. And they were like, oh, so which Man United player would play best in jeans? And
then they knew what they were doing.
They didn't clock it. And then at the end, Poet just goes, Lukaku. And then Ashley Young's just there, like, trying to hold it
in. Yeah, he
like,
has to hold it because he knew.
I was like, they know.
Poet and Vooj don't know what they're trying to do.
Yeah, obviously, they do.
We just had international duty, obviously. Big up England. But why didn't you come to the game with us yesterday?
I asked in the group, and look, I was telling Darren this before. Jermaine just doesn't bring me through to anything. Like,
nah, he's trying to snitch on me today.
Literally,
hi Darren, so this man don't bring me in on anything.
This weekend it was Jermaine's 60th birthday, and he didn't bring me in. He didn't bring me through,
bro. I told you.
And then Sunday, I put in the group. I was like, anyone going England Croatia trying to like give the old like.
Did you ask that question?
A little nudge.
You didn't ask that question.
Yeah, check the group. All right, okay, I've got the receipts.
Nah, bro, you ain't got no receipts, bro. I felt bad, man. I had bare tickets.
This guy. Oh, look on, man. It looked lit. Hang on one sec. Let me find it.
No, it's not. See, it doesn't exist.
But I haven't even typed the group chat in yet about it doesn't exist. Chill out,
I know
man.
Hella rappers in there, innit?
Yeah.
Put my video up,
you're
bro.
You're my guy. Yeah.
Put my freestyle up,
are you guys going to be at the Croatia game on Sunday?
I can see it.
But that's not a question.
You got hella air
still. That ain't a question. Hey, but that's all that bumping around. Are you going to be at the game? Why don't you just ask a question?
He's asking though, still.
Yeah, I'm not going to be like, yo, bust me a ticket, my guy.
Hey, what, did you go to the game?
Put the dealers out.
Did you go to the game?
I didn't go to the game, no.
Oh, man. It was actually quite a good game. I'm not going to lie.
Hey,
I'm happy.
What do you think about this UEFA
Nations League? What do you think? Because obviously they're trying to say it's supposed to make everything a bit more competitive. I'm not going to lie. I'm feeling it now.
Yeah.
At first, I thought it was
I don't know
dead.
Why I was celebrating, but I
thought it was dead.
Was
yeah, like, same.
Okay, yeah. I was like, I don't know why I'm happy.
Hey, Ben ain't feeling it. Look at his face. I ain't falling for it.
No, I like it, but I don't understand how it works. Still,
no, no one does. No one does. This is about relegation, like A3 to A4 like to B2. Yeah,
10 minutes
like
ago, we're about to get relegated. Then 10 minutes after, we won the thing. I'm just like, I don't know what's going on right now. But
I don't think anybody fully understands it.
No,
but there's like they got like the finals in Portugal or something, innit?
I don't know.
In the summer. Yeah.
In the summer.
These lot are gonna go. I probably won't get invited.
Yeah, we're going.
I allow it. But look, do you know what I find funny?
Yeah, you know all this promotion. What happens is like you get teams like Macedonia who gets promoted to C. Like. But they're just gonna go straight back down. Like a lot of the time. Like I'm just being real.
Like Gibraltar won their first ever game in the UEFA.
Yeah, they did, which is great for the smaller teams. 100%.
Like that, you know what I mean?
And I thought that was the whole purpose of it, to give like other teams a chance.
Just let them have a little.
But what do you think is gonna take for UEFA Nations League to be on the same prestigious like level as like Euro 2020, whatever?
It's gotta be exciting, isn't it? I think when
because it is exciting though, it is exciting.
It'll never be on that level.
But Darren, that's what I want to ask you quickly, yeah? Because when you were playing, obviously, club football, yeah? Why is it, genuinely, yeah? Why is it that the League Cup wasn't, like, just seen as anywhere near as important as the FA Cup? Like, what's the reason?
I don't get it either because, obviously, when I was at Ipswich Town, when I was at Charlton, to be fair, we took it seriously because we were quite realist, Alan Kirbishley. He knew that was probably the only trophy we had a chance of winning.
Oh, Curbs, legend.
Curbs, big up. It was like, he used to play a strong team round after round after round because he wants to win a trophy at the end of the day. Like the top teams, I can get it. Like obviously Manchester City's, you know, Arsenal's, United's, I get it because they've got that many players. You know what I mean? They've got Champions League, a lot of games. They've got the League games, they've got the FA Cup games. They've got, do you know what I mean? So I understand that. But say like a team like Tottenham, for instance, if I was them, I'd be going all out to win this trophy.
Because, 100%.
Because they need to win something.
Yeah, no, 100%.
New stadium, they got Champions League, yeah, they've got a manager's on the brink of potentially going somewhere else. Mm. They need to start producing and winning trophies.
Mm. Are you, so you're not one of them guys who, like, when United win, like, a Carling Cup, you're not like, yeah, but there's only a, like, a Carling Cup, that's like, still...
It's still a cup.
Because it's a trophy. At the end of the day, it's still a trophy, and it's still... Like, so, I mean, I don't know if it's a way into Europe, I can't remember, but at the end of the day, like, for Manchester City, I get the priorities, but for someone like Tottenham, who's a top four team, but still not winning anything, they need to go all out to win that trophy.
No, but we were saying that, we've been saying it all season anyway, we said that with Liverpool and Spurs, we know at the moment, their main thing is silverware.
Any trophy. But if you're a Man United, if you're a Man City, Carling Cup means nothing.
Nothing to you, Even Manchester United, even though Manchester United are struggling, because they won it so recently, they should have been actually progressing to
team of a certain stature as well. You guys are supposed to be winning your FA Cups, your Premier Leagues, your Champions League.
Do you know what? Someone like Manchester City, though, with a manager like Guardiola, I think that he takes the League Cup seriously for development of Manchester City youngsters because, and other teams might not do that, but I think for him, being the manager that he is, he probably sees that as equally as important for the development because he's got that many good youngsters in the team. He wants to get them ready.
Of course.
He's lucky, though. He's got three first teams.
He's got so many.
For him, it's fine. Like, he can put a second team out, it still looks like a first team. Yeah.
How do you feel about this like new wave of England youngsters? And like, did you ever want to go play in some of foreign leagues like a Jordan, like a Jadon Sancho? Reece Nelson, who's at Hoffenheim. Like, did you ever think about doing that? Like, going like, you know what, let me go bad up front because you can actually score goals.
Do you know what it was? It was when I was young, like when I was about 16. I got in the team quite early, so I didn't really have to go anywhere else to like go on loan. Like, obviously, I got in the team, was playing regularly at 17, then moved to Charlton, so I didn't have to go out. But for the youngsters now, like 100%, and there's no point going, like for me, there's no point leaving a Premier League side to go on loan to like League One, League Two, because they're not going to get anything out of it.
Right. Do you know what I mean? It's different nowadays as well. It's so much harder
But do you find that back in the day, people chose, just like you said, do you think they chose to even go to, let's say, a weaker team or a league below in the same country rather than go to Germany?
100% because they thought, obviously, that back then there wasn't that many English players going out abroad, but if they're quite homely, obviously they don't want to go too far, so they go, you know what, let me drop down to League One, let me drop down to League Two because I don't really want to go out there. Whereas nowadays, like, the youngsters are like, well, now hold on a second, dear, like, I'm not going to go and play in League One, not develop, I might as well go and play Dortmund or
do the Bundesliga actually, like, better your game. I think it's actually been helping more than anything.
I agree,
because it adds like,
if you look at Jadon Sancho, I can guarantee you right now he wouldn't be in the position he is right now if you said it, man.
100%
guarantee you that. Because he's gone to the Bundesliga, he's had to experience a different life.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
You know, learn a new language, learn a new setup. He's been given chances, because in Germany they give their youngsters a lot of chances out there. But if he was at Man City, he'd be playing a couple Carling Cup wins here and there. And that's it.
What do you think is the differences between this England now and like maybe the England that you played for? Like, what do you think is making it gel so much? Do you think it's just Southgate's a genius and the way he's put these men together?
He's definitely a major factor, because I think back in the day with the old England managers, it was too much on reputation. It was too much like...
True. Yeah, that's... Isn't it? We always say it's that. True. Like, it was like before you knew what seven were going to get picked.
Exactly.
Straight away. Yeah,
like regardless of their form.
Regardless of form.
Exactly. So even if they got an injury and they're not 100% fit, they're 40% fit, they'd rather go and take someone who's 40% fit for Man United rather than someone who's playing week in, week out well for someone like Leicester or something like that.
Yeah.
Whereas the Southgate has gone, you know what, I'd rather go and pick someone who's playing in the Championship but playing week in, week out well than someone who's sitting on the bench for a Premier League side.
And I think
it's helping, because now players are going meeting up with their country, playing on form.
Yeah.
They're playing games, they're fit, they're ready to go, and we're not been sitting on their... You know,
of course.
Yeah, and players are getting rewarded. Like we were talking about yesterday.
Callum Wilson.
Players like Callum Wilson would have just been overlooked.
You know more than anyone that, you know, confidence and form plays a big factor in terms of how you're going to play, especially for England. And I think nowadays, I've got to give Southgate a lot of praise, because I was ruining him.
When he came in?
Yeah, when he came in, I was like,
what is it?
I was like, why have you got this, you know, this donut as our manager? I'll be completely honest. I was like, why is he our manager?
Call him a donut.
Last year, I don't know. I can't swear on here, so I have to, keep it PC. But no, I was like, you know, the last job he's had was at what, Middlesbrough.
Yeah.
I was like, why has he come in and got the top job already? But I've got to give it to him.
But you know what? England
changed your philosophy.
England had managers like Sven.
He understands that.
England had managers like Sven. They had Fabio Capello, and they weren't nowhere near us.
To be fair, me and Defoe used to talk all the time, and we always used to feel that we had to go above and beyond just to even get selected. Not Warren getting on the pitch.
Yeah.
Just to even get in the squad.
But how did it work? Put on the tracksuit and chilling the cold.
But Darren, how did it work back then? Was it a case that, like, obviously, I've always wanted to know stuff like this, isn't it? So is it a case, you know, when you're waiting for the call up, is it like, do you get a text saying, sorry, mate? Or like, you're in.
Not today, my guy.
Do you know what it was? For international, they've had the 2-game week.
Yeah.
You get a text, but you kind of know when it comes.
You know what's mad when the man in message you like, what did you get the text?
How you're playing? Like I knew if I score and playing, I knew I was gonna be in the squad.
Yeah.
But I always knew, like I knew at the end of the season, say it was World Cup or European competition. I always felt, I didn't know, matter how many goals I scored in the season, I knew it was coming because I felt like they'd already set their minds on the squad they were going to take.
Yeah.
So like, for instance, when I was at Charlton, I scored the 22 and didn't go to the World Cup.
I remember that was a bit.
That was mad.
Sunderland scored 25, didn't go to the World Cup. But after the first
World Cup, was that again?
That was 2010, was it?
2010.
2010, so I scored 25. But even after I scored the 25, I was at my mum's house and I said to her, I know what's coming. I know what's coming. She was like, no, it's impossible. It can't happen.
Yeah.
Got the phone calls at my mum's house. It was Capello on the phone, and he just said to me, "Hi, Darren. Listen, I'm not going to take you this time. Like, you've done really, really well, but because I dealt with it before, like, I know how to get on with it. I know how to deal with it again."
Apart from me, I would want to argue.
I'd be like, "Fabio, come on, bro. Come on,
bro. Do you see what man's doing?"
I'd have gone next level. I'd have started saying mad stuff to him. Like, I would not have it.
That's what's so mad. And then you start hearing, you know, Darren is not a professional.
I can't
talk some rubbish, man.
Yeah.
I think it's so difficult for like certain players at certain times. But obviously, big up all these new guys, man. Because at the moment, the team, they gel well, they play well.
It's the first time I've been excited about England since Euro 2004, 2006, maybe World Cup 2006, maybe, because obviously in 2004 we probably should have won that tournament in the Euros, and since then I don't feel like I've had the same.
I think even 2002 England were good, but they were just obviously Brazil were just a level above everybody, but England were still good. They lost
still competing.
But do you think there's any factor with like, because some people say this, could it kind of in a negative way, that the quality of international teams has gone down. That's why England are now elevated to be one of the top teams. Or do you feel England have really stepped through? Because obviously people say, look, quality teams like Argentina, Brazil are nowhere near what they used to be.
Netherlands, you know, we said Netherlands, Italy,
Germany, even now.
It just comes around in cycles, I think. Like, obviously England have had a couple of like average tournaments. And obviously now this is their time. They've got they've got a good crop of youngsters that are young.
Exactly.
They all seem to be friends, like not just work colleagues, they're friends.
Yeah.
They're all playing at the top clubs in England as well. They're all nailing down positions here, there and everywhere, all over the globe, as you said, Germany, these places.
Mm-hmm.
So these next few years are now crucial. Like, this is like England's time, which is why everyone's kind of getting excited, because they had a good World Cup. Obviously, they got a little bit lucky on the side of the board they were on, because they could have been on the other side.
Yeah.
But let's not take nothing away. They went to Spain, you know what I mean, a couple of weeks ago, battered Spain, beat Spain.
Yeah.
And I think that was the one marquee result which made everyone go, oh, okay, like,
we can play.
England are complaining, and now starting to go in the right direction.
100%.
Even coming back. So anyway, listen, let us know in the comments below what you think about England. Do you reckon we can actually do something in the next Euros?
It's coming home, mate.
And is
it coming home?
It's coming
in our lifetime, at least.
Hey, so obviously on me and Jay's show, a BBC show yesterday.
Ooh,
yesterday,
we
had a, hold on, wait. We had a question. We had a question, a little bit controversial. Yeah, we have to know everyone's thoughts here. Yeah, there were rumors that came out. Yeah.
Wait, what's this?
The Wayne Rooney obviously said. Yeah, I'm sure everyone heard that there is one player, okay? Did he say one player?
He just goes, oh, certain players are not really happy about these crop of England players.
Yeah.
Oh,
okay.
I'm not like, but it's the way he tried to exclude himself, like, I'm not like that, you know, I don't really feel like that. we were asking
who do we think
it is? Or what player we think it is that is not really feeling the current crop of England players or whatever. I reckon, I don't...
What do you mean? Is it like...
You
can't say it, can you? Do you think you know who it is?
No, I got a guess, innit? Who do you reckon it is?
I don't know.
What format? Yeah, you know
I don't know.
I don't know. Yeah, smart.
I can't miss my promotion. I can't miss my promotion.
Yeah. I'm trying to cancel them TV gigs, guys. I'm trying to get the pundit game up. You know what's there? In the studio, we have Darren Bent. All right, Darren. Yeah.
We're going down to like the Football League show now.
Hey, I know. Well, we'll let you guys decide. Okay. I reckon.
Go
on, say it. Go on, big man. Say
no, no, because in the group chat, man, are saying Paul Scholes because they were saying, Paul Scholes comes across as that sort of person.
Yeah. Do you know what I will say? Is that I don't know who it could be, but like I can understand. Like, well, I don't get it because obviously I'm from that culture. But if you were an old school England footballer, been taught a certain way. Obviously, you're gonna see that on social media. You're gonna see people like Jesse, Marcus Rashford dancing and all that. And obviously, it's not gonna fit the criteria of when they was coming through.
Yeah.
So obviously, they're gonna have something to say over it. It's about like you talk about Formula One, Lewis Hamilton, the way he goes on. You know for a fact them old school Formula One drivers hate it.
Because
he's not towing that same line.
And you know, one thing we did say about all of this before as well. That the fact is, you know, regardless of how good this England team's playing at the moment, 10 years ago, the starting 11 was better on paper.
Well, it sounds like, the it was better on paper,
And I think maybe there was, I wouldn't say jealousy or bitterness, but it's probably a little bit of frustration from these guys where they probably thought,
100%.
Well, how did we not with that team?
Yeah.
Do
better, Why did we not gel? Yeah, why did we let those?
I said it's just timing again because when England were at their best, we could say at their best, like Gerrard, Lampard, and Scholes. They had people like Ronaldo, Ronaldinho, Rivaldo to deal with.
Yeah,
Maldini.
Yeah. Mad.
These, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Pirlo.
Pirlo, all these guys here.
All these guys, it's true.
It's a bit mad. Obviously, Jack, your time now. Your team Fulham has started making a few changes.
I'm moving like Mr. Burns. Like, excellent.
What are you saying? Obviously, I'm not going to lie though. Hey, you see when... what's his name? Jokanović.
That is the worst pronunciation.
Hey, no, I always get it wrong.
The other week, he called Thibaut Courtois. No, yeah, so...
Yeah, Jokanović, yeah. So bro, the way he was crying in the group chat was mad sad.
I was upset. Like, I think, you know, he deserves a chance to see out a bit longer because, the situation in which he turned up at Fulham in, we were like 18th, 19th.
Yeah, you said relegation in the championship.
We were awful. I can't lie. We were looking bad. Like, those few years were tense. Like, literally, I hate it. Like, it was like going to church. I didn't want to go. Like, I was turning up.
I was just turning up.
It wasn't like a Spat Nation church where they're doing drill and all that. It was literally like, turn up, okay, 4-1, everyone's booing, I left, and that was it. He came in, he turned everything around for us, and I think to sack him this early after him getting promoted.
I think
it's a bit of a joke.
Yeah, but Jack, do you not go by that saying sometimes when they say managers can take you to a certain point?
No, I get that. I fully do. And I think if you are going to sack a manager, the best time to do it is before an international break because it gives them 2 weeks to work with the team, everything gel and all that sort of stuff. But I just think he deserved more. I think especially after the Liverpool game where we started showing signs of improving, we really should have
that game was so unfortunate, bro.
My blood pressure this year has been crazy.
Dad,
you know what's funny about him is every time they're playing, you can tell what the result is because he's sending voice notes.
Bro, he's sending voice notes
and he's just getting upset.
Bro, I'm not gonna lie, because that one was basically it was the mad offside goal, innit? Yeah, Mitrovic scores his header.
I mean, it was technically offside, but...
And then it was the way Salah just sprinted.
I was voice noting to celebrate. Next thing I know, as I'm about to end it, Salah's got the ball in his head. I was like, hang on a second.
Hold on.
I was like, quick swipe, delete that, bro. I was like, no way.
Now, but what didn't help you guys as well was that the Cardiff, Huddersfield, Newcastle all have come to form. That's the problem.
I don't say come to form like that.
They have come to form.
They won a couple games.
Cardiff beat Brighton Tech with a 10-man Brighton team and they had to get an offside goal to win it.
Exactly.
Do me a favour.
Allow it.
New Warner.
And then Don took off his shirt, didn't even get a yellow card. It's a joke to you.
But no, like, obviously, you guys know I'm a big Fulham fan and Mr. Darren Bent over here used to play for Fulham. We've met now. The beef is squashed.
What beef? Why is there beef?
Even though Darren would still batter me if it came to a fight. I think you would know the relationship with Fulham fans isn't the best.
Yeah.
And why do you reckon that is?
No, I don't know because obviously when I first went down there, like it started off really well. It was going really well.
Scored in your debut, didn't you?
Scored a debut, I remember scoring against Stoke, scoring against Norwich. And it was going really well. But for whatever reason, it was like my fortune there turned when like my gat got the job.
Yeah.
And obviously, then you're fighting to get in the team, then you're not in the team, then he leaves you out, then he brings you back. And it's just, you obviously lose your head, lack of form.
Yeah.
And obviously, it obviously coincided with Fulham weren't doing, we weren't doing great anyway. We were on the verge of going down.
Yeah.
And I think obviously the last Stoke game when the Fulham fans turned on me was boiling point anyway, because obviously what's crazy is that I wasn't even supposed to start that game. Mm. Hugo was supposed to start, but he got ill the night before.
Yeah.
So he couldn't play. So I was obviously playing. We're going down 4-1.
Obviously, and then I remember you went through on goal, and I think you scuffed it, and it went like
it went wide, yeah,
it went really far wide.
Yeah, it went wide.
And then everyone,
were you at home?
Bro, that's mad. Do you have to remember all these misses and that?
But that was quite pivotal, because I remember that after he'd missed that, everyone like lost it. We were relegated at this point. Mm. Everyone was losing it. But I think for me, what I found quite weird was how Mullenstein just disappeared. Like, they just sacked him after we played Liverpool at home and lost 3-2 in the last minute.
And we played so well that game. Yeah.
We played so well. And I thought, do you know what? We look like we can stay up now. Mm. And then suddenly, next day, they went, oh no, we brought McGaffey now because he became available.
Mm.
And did you guys know about this beforehand? Or was it...
What was that like?
For me, like, I thought it looked a bit dodgy, in my opinion, the way in which everything's just suddenly changed.
To be fair, what should have happened was that, yeah, you're right, we had, obviously, Martin Jol,
of course.
Yep. Yeah.
Then they brought in Rennie Muiristein, but they also brought in Alan Kerbishley, who was like an advisor.
Yeah, like a director.
Muiristein went, they should have just given Kerbs the job to the end of the season, because I believe that he would have got the best out of the players. He knew the Premier League.
Yeah.
He knew how to manage. He knew how to manage in them situations where a team's struggling, he can get them over the line. But they went completely out the way and went to Magat.
It was the most ridiculous decision.
And even as players, we would get turned up to train every day not knowing what to expect, because it went from one extreme to like things like the gym being closed, not being allowed in the gym, training for long hours. Like you'd play a game on the Saturday, play 90 minutes, and then you expect you to fully train on the Sunday, so you've got like more senior players like myself.
I heard that happened with the Stoke game. You guys had to play 90 minutes and training.
More senior players like myself, Scotty Parker, Steve Sidwell,
just
played a whole 90 minutes, and then we've got to go and train fully the next day.
Yeah.
Or if we didn't play well, we're just running on the Sunday.
I heard another rumour as well, that one day you guys were set up with him as if it was like an 11-a-side game, and he made you just stand in your position for like a good, I don't know, like half an hour, 45 minutes.
Yeah, he basically stood us in those positions, but he put a pole that was about 15 yards away. And every time he blew his whistle, we had to run to this pole and run back. And we did it for about an hour.
What? Why?
Brother, what kind of madness is this?
Literally, some of the stories I've heard about McGaffey.
Yeah, he thought differently. Like, there was times where we'd have to train on the Sunday, as I said, but we'd go there out to training and he'd be like, right, you lot didn't want to play football yesterday in the game, so you lot aren't going to play today, so just run.
So basically,
we'd just be doing like big laps around the
training. Sounds like a boot camp.
And when he blew the whistle, when he blew the whistle, we'd have to sprint. When he blew it, we'd stop. We had to just keep going. But even the fitness guy who was taking us, he didn't even know how long it was going on for, because he would just like run.
You know, at some point, is there not at least one player who just says, nah, F this, I'm not doing it.
Yeah, but you know what's so bad? Because you know what it is? We always laugh at, because I sometimes get annoyed with players, innit?
Yeah.
When they turn on their managers, like especially recently happened with Conte. Who else has happened to? Gary Monk, Swansea. Like where you always hear these stories. Even Ranieri.
Yeah,
like,
Ranieri,
when before he got kicked from Leicester, you heard them rumours that the players have turned against him.
And obviously Jose Mourinho at Chelsea. Yeah. Same thing.
Jose Mourinho everywhere.
Everywhere
he goes, the players turn against him. And sometimes you don't really know why. Sometimes you hear like little things like, oh, they took away ketchup, or they made him change the diet.
Yeah.
Or, what, the ketchup things, what, is that one a bit... Is that a bit of a sore
one? No.
I eat mayonnaise.
I take my ketchup.
I don't particularly like ketchup, but I've had managers before that have like removed ketchup and stuff like that, yeah.
Yeah, but
how did the players react? Did they get?
But for me,
I'm not being funny. No. Like here, like obviously, man, look at me. Man loves ketchup.
He likes a lot of things, mate.
But the players like really, is that like a major thing for players when they're like, no,
ketchup?
Actually, yeah, the ketchup. Like whenever they make them change the diet, does that really annoy them? I think it does.
So, it annoys them when you're obviously in a routine. Maybe not ketchup, but like if you're in a routine of eating certain foods and then the menus completely change. It's different if they like remove one or two bits and replace it, but they're still...
When you get that brand new menu,
when the whole thing just completely changed.
Everyday like, broccoli. You're making raw.
But then when you go to the manager and say to him, listen, this ain't working for me, I need something else. And he's like, nope. Then that's when the problem starts.
Darren, do you believe in, obviously, because the way I see it, just to say, you know, all this losing dressing room stuff, I don't know like how you would, but the way I always see it is, you know, when they say, oh, they're not playing for their manager, or oh, they're not turning up, they're not playing well purposely because they want the manager to get sacked.
Is that true?
I want to know, firstly, is it true? Because the way I see it is like, why wouldn't you play for your own legacy, your own like performance, even if the manager's there or not. Because if the manager moves on, you've just played badly for 6 months trying to get a manager out. You see what I mean?
I don't think any player goes at their purposely to play badly for a manager. I mean, psychologically, it might be there.
Mm.
Because the amount of times where a player won't play well for a manager, a new one comes in, next thing you know, they take off and they play really well.
Yeah. Savage. That's what's going to happen at Fulham.
Yeah, it's like, I don't think players mean to do that, but psychologically, sometimes it would look like that from an outside perspective.
Yeah,
you know, where you think, well, why were you not playing like that a week ago when the manager was there? But then I get, if you get a manager like it's, I can imagine sometimes it being quite hard to play for Mourinho, as good as he is.
Yeah.
If he's coming out publicly criticising you left, right, and centre, at some stage
it can get difficult.
As a man, it's going to start to bother you.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
Yeah, go back to McGaff quickly. there was obviously, I found it ridiculous that he tired you guys out. So when you know, even watching games, I remember the whole game when I think it was 2-2, and we conceded the second goal, and you guys just looked knackered. I couldn't believe it. It was like 75 minutes in. I was like, yeah, that's it. We're done. Mm. And obviously they had the story about Hanglin with the cheese. So I don't know if you two know.
No,
there's a route. There's a rumor.
It's true.
Wow. Yeah, it's true. So basically, I think from what I've heard, Hanglin had a hamstring injury or something like that, and the physio was like, yeah, we're gonna do the standard procedure to deal with the issue, and he went, no, I've got this German remedy where you you strap a bit of cheese to the leg, and I thought, no, he's got to be joking. Apparently, it's true.
It's true.
Yeah,
really.
So what? How's it going with the boy? The cheddar? What?
Yeah, so yeah.
The mild cheddar on the leg.
Explain it a bit more, because I only know like wishy washy, around that story. But
that's all we knew. That is, Breda come out and just said to us, "Listen," he just said to me there with my hamstring injury, "if I put cheese on it, that will help heal it."
Was there any other weird things? Was that the only weird thing that happened, or were there any other weird things that happened when he was there?
That was the weirdest, like, as in pinpoint thing I can think of.
I'm not surprised.
But as far as other stuff, no, the whole setup was just weird.
Yeah.
We weren't geared and we weren't ready for that at that stage of the season to go in something so intense and so different from what
we were
used to.
We started Moussa Dembele during that time, didn't we?
Yeah.
We literally out of nowhere grabbed him out of the academy, put him straight in the...
Pulled a hamstring after like 10 minutes.
This was lit.
He's still lit though.
Yeah, but I think it was way too early for him, especially at that time of the season. I think there was just so many weird decisions that happened. But then obviously, the Stoke things happened and, things went a bit south from there. And then obviously the way football works, we bumped into you again in Brighton.
Hey, wait, tell them how long you was in Brighton for. You said you was in Brighton for like four weeks.
And he still managed to play Fulham somehow.
What are the chances?
But no, it's funny because big up my boy Ollie. He probably will be watching this. He got kicked out because of you.
Sorry, Ollie.
you missed both the goals that we scored after. So basically, we're giving you
this
stick.
Guy's got memory like it.
We're giving Darren a lot of stick, bear in mind. And, he's getting it all game. He comes on, it's 0-0.
What were you thinking at that moment? Real talk. When I score, is that what you were thinking? All I was thinking was,
when they were giving me the stick, every time I was, like, obviously down that end, I was thinking, just give me one chance. I remember I had one chance, like, header, keeper saved them. Thinking, come on, it's got to give me another
one.
And
then they did.
And they're like, hey. All game, I'm thinking, all right, I was definitely doing that.
I was definitely that guy. But no, it was weird because I remember that game. I was just like, whatever you do, like, we're giving you stick. I was like, please don't score. Yeah. I was like, I beg you. And then obviously he scored in like the 50.
Straight after half time.
He bangs it. And
what was your celebration?
He ran the full length of the pitch.
Was it worse than Adebayor one?
No. It wasn't that bad.
I think I stopped about halfway.
Because Adebayor sprinted.
Literally, he's in the other end. He runs all the way down. He cups his ears like that. And I remember, I've never seen so many guys get out of their seat and run down on my mum's life half the away and they're trying to get on the pitch.
All these players
are like holding them back, and I'm one of them. Like, I'm trying to grab you, but I'm trying to get you, but no, because I think it was when you ran over.
There's a little beer in there getting gassed up.
And a couple of cans, mate. But no, literally, I think it was Hugo that tried to stop you and grab you to go back. Yeah, it was Hugo that did that. And then obviously we won 2-1.
That's why I wanted to tell the story.
That's what killed me.
I can imagine because I remember you did an interview after the game and I could tell. I was just looking at your face. I was like, yeah. I was still a bit drunk watching it. Like, yeah. How about that? Yeah. How about that?
I want to ask you, though, as a goal scorer, VAR. Mm-hmm. surely there must be countless goals, fouls, where you're like, these decisions are pivotal decisions in the game. We've been arguing about VAR because I don't know if you heard the news, but they're pushing it forward, so we're definitely going to be getting it soon. What do you think about this whole VAR thing? Be real. Do you feel like it's going to slow down the game too much? Because Akeem's like not really on it.
I like it, but you can't have situations like you had in the World Cup where sometimes for stupid decisions, it was taking a referee like 3 minutes
that
you could work out. Like, I could work out sitting at home in 30 seconds.
Yeah.
And they have to run over to someone.
That bit makes it there.
That they need to get someone, maybe to, I know you can't influence the referee's decision, but maybe to someone to go, to sit there and watch the screen and go, right, I don't think it's a penalty. It's up to you whether you come over and have a look at it. But to get the ref running over there every 2 seconds.
And you know, and it starts to get a little bit same.
Really
people constantly doing this
all the time,
Constant.
Because there's, when you, in the game, when you're doing stuff and the first time you see it, you go, that's not a foul. But if you slow it down, it then start, you go, oh, maybe it could be a foul because obviously you can slow it right down.
Yeah.
But obviously, get while the game's going on, you might be like, that's never been a foul. So I think I think you need to start booking players if they're going to start doing that.
Yeah.
But also, I also think maybe they should not limit it to how many they can do in a game.
That's what everyone's been saying. Yeah,
because you can't be down 6-7 times. Like,
that's the only bit that makes it long.
Then it turns
into
cricket.
But what I'm trying to say is it'll be good though.
I think
if you miss, if you get fouled in the box or like you're saying, or there's like a goal that just creeps over the line or something, and you're thinking, I'm confident this went over the line.
But you know, that's the problem though. Because what happened is when there's a potentially penalty, everyone would do that because it'll slow down the game. It'll worry it'll stress out the striker taking the penalty. The striker will be standing there for 5 minutes worried. They'll probably miss the penalty.
Yeah.
Just because you've caught. Do you get what I mean? So people will tactically do it just to.
Even if they know it's a foul, they'll start doing this.
Exactly.
Yeah. It's silly. Yeah. I think that's where it starts getting out of hand. When everything gets called up for VAR, it turns into cricket.
I still feel like it's needed now more than ever.
Yeah, I agree.
Because decisions in the Premier League
are getting so... After last weekend or 2 weeks ago, I was fully behind
Southampton. Yeah. You see that Charlie Austin rat?
He was not happy.
They need help. It's the Premier League. Most watched thing in the league.
I agree with Dan though. I think you should have a guy, you know, being able to, you know, on an earpiece or something like that, feeding him information, telling him that, I don't know if that should be, you know, so rather than going back and forth 24/7, like
it's going to kill the game. It's going to start to annoy people.
All right, let's get into these Premier League fixtures. Because we're actually back in the Premier League this week.
Big one for us, mate. Massive one for us.
What you got?
Southampton at home.
Oh, nice.
You're going to come? Wait. I've got a spare ticket if you want to come. Are you
going to come?
I've got a guy behind me. He loves you.
You know what? Before we even go into this, Darren, on your team, how do you think you're doing at the moment?
On what team?
Your team you support.
Arsenal, I think we're going all right.
Yeah,
I think we're doing all right. I think we're going in the right direction. Listen, I'm not going to get carried away.
Good.
Don't give me this unbeaten run talk. No, I'm not hearing it.
I've seen the good days of early 2000s, so I'm not going to get carried away. But if they can keep this form going, then top four, I think, is reasonable.
It's possible.
Okay, cool.
Does it feel mad the fact that Spurs are like still ahead of you though? Because Spurs are like grinding out these wins kind of thing.
But you know though, you ask any Spurs fan, and listen, they probably lie. But if you say to them, you look at the last, say, 5 years of how Spurs have done and how Arsenal's done, and Spurs have seen us doing better than Arsenal, but Arsenal won 2 trophies in that time. Spurs have won none, so...
Yeah, we know about the trophy. Yeah. Like, when it comes to the trophy, Spurs can't really talk.
That's what it's about.
But Spurs right now, when it comes to this whole...
League form.
The league form, they do a lot better in the league at the moment. The last couple of years, they've been doing it.
Yeah, I hear that.
I think if they finish above you this season, that'll be third season.
Yeah, but they do need to win trophies.
Something.
They just got to win something.
Come on, just anything.
Little league, anything. Brother, and you're actually good.
Trust me, I think we've been in more finals than Tottenham in the last 8 or 9 years.
I actually wouldn't be surprised.
Have you?
Yeah.
No, I wouldn't actually
be surprised. Final, mate. Good old Darren
Bent. Here we go.
All the Darren Bent days.
Yeah. I'm messing.
Bro. So, Tom, what do you think about City's football? Are there any other players at the moment that when you watch them play, you're like, bruv, this is unreal? Like, see, like when you see a team like Manchester City's, like, what would you, like, do you ever think, like, is this...
Where does it rank in what
Premier League? Is it one of the best Premier League teams you've ever seen?
Arsenal's or to Man United's at their best?
Like, is it one of the best you've ever seen play ball? Be honest.
Yeah, it's got to be. It's definitely one of them. I mean, the way they play the game of Guardiola and the way they're just dismantling teams, you've got to put them up there. Obviously, they've had one season, or two seasons, haven't they? They didn't win the first one.
Finished third, no trophies.
So I don't think right now you can compare them to, say, Manchester United, or, you know what I mean, winning Premier League.
Because the legacy,
Four, five, six, seven, do you know what I mean? Or the Arsenal early 2000s, who went unbeaten all season. Mm. You know, these are two like, iconic teams. Mm. But as far as right now and how they're going, like they've got to be one of the... probably the favourite in the Champions League, maybe, the way they're going about their business.
Yeah. Everyone's saying that, but I don't think they're good enough to be in the Champions League.
I don't think they're good enough to be in the Champions League.
No, not in it, but they're not good enough to win it. No, they're not good enough to win it.
Your birthday hangover.
He was waiting to say
that. I don't think they're good.
Freedom passing that.
They were favourites to actually win it before the Lyon game, and then I still think that they still got a lot.
They've clearly got the best team. But they obviously, I think Liverpool have the best defense.
They slapped Shakhtar. Yeah, but they slapped them.
Six goals.
Yeah. They slapped Shakhtar. Is hard.
Definite pen for Sterling as well.
That pen. That's why you need this VAR thing.
The man are doing the ghost pen. But you know what? Liverpool's got the best defense. But Darren, just quick question before we go on to fixtures. What is the best defender you came up against ever in your career? Off the top of your head, like some of the best.
I'd have to put the top three. I can't even say.
Yeah.
Definitely Thiago Silva was one.
Oh yeah. Okay.
Yeah. It was him and Lucio centre backs. It was like
Lucio. Wow.
Impossible.
Yeah.
Impossible.
Against Brazil and probably Sergio Ramos.
Ramos, yeah.
Yeah, Ramos is. Just, you know, he's just animal, like dirty, just, but it'll do it in a way that he's not going to get sent off, but you feel it still. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
A bit like what happened to Mo Salah in the final.
Liverpool players are still talking about it.
Yeah, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, you see Lovren. Yeah.
Have you not seen this little Lovren and Ramos beef? Yeah, I kind of rate Lovren though,
Yeah, he doesn't. I rate him, but what can you really say to a man who's won European Champions League?
I think he literally won everything.
He has, definitely. From playing since he was like 19, he's won and he keeps liking pictures on Instagram of him kissing trophies and that. Have you seen it? Yeah. As in, like, in the pictures, him in the Champions League, like Lovren and that. Looking at Lovren like, buddy, you're not seeing none of this stuff here, bro. Mate. Yeah, so that's actually jokes. Yeah, that's actually kind of peak though. I'm not gonna lie. Those sorts of players.
If you talk about domestic level, like Ledley King, man.
Ooh.
The man that never trained.
Yeah,
I promise you, that guy, like freak of nature. Yeah. Wow. Anyone who ever talks about him, if you ever hear people talk about him, freak of nature, man. Never used to train.
Yeah.
Swim on a Friday, turn up, man the match.
Crazy.
Every week.
That's crazy.
Mad. If his knees weren't such a state, then
that's what I'm trying to say. Yeah, it would have been. Yeah, it would have been curtains.
Like, he would have been, you know, in the England squad.
No, 100%. 100%, bro. All right, cool. What are you saying about?
Wait, one more thing. What do you think about Harry Redknapp on I'm a Celebrity?
It started now, isn't it? Man has to watch Uncle Hazard do this thing tonight.
It shocked me at first because I've never, obviously, known Harry the way I do. I never ever thought he'd have gone on something like that.
Yeah.
No, I'm sure he was at home like, what, bit of cockroaches?
I need to see a bit of crabs.
I know he's
looking at a crab. I tried to sign him at Tottenham. he's a good little player, that crab.
I could probably do that, mate. That's not really a problem. Jump out of plane. Mate, I've done way worse things than that, mate.
All that's going to be fun is when he's eating them, chewing his face. Hey. That is going to be gold, man. Honestly,
it's funny though because they're smart because now everyone's going
I'm
gonna
to watch it.
Every football fan's going to be like, "What? I read up on I'm a Celebrity. Yeah. Man has to at least catch the highlights."
I'm definitely watching it.
Sam Allardyce needs to go next year.
All right, some quick predictions before we go.
Quick prediction.
All right, so big game so far, Tottenham versus Chelsea.
Is that
where is it?
At Wembley.
Chelsea, I win. 2-1.
This guy don't. But you're gonna say that because Spurs. I don't hate Spurs.
You know what I mean,
I used to play, man.
I drew my time when I was there, but I think right now Chelsea again in our direction where they're gonna start. Obviously, Morata's starting to find a bit of form.
I think they're gonna win this game
2-1. And plus, they always seem to beat Tottenham anyway. So
yeah, that's actually true.
I don't know. I'm going to.
I reckon it's gonna be a draw though. I reckon it's gonna be a bit of a draw. What are you saying?
I'm gonna go for a draw as well.
Another big one, which I think is quite a big one: Watford versus Liverpool.
Why do you think that's a big one?
Because you see, even when you lot play, look, he doesn't want to talk about it. I'm telling you now.
I'm not sure that's a big game.
You see Watford, them men are hard to wipe out. Listen, you lot just struggled with them the other day. You're talking like, they were straggling you lot until you got that little equaliser.
That was Wolves.
Oh, that was Wolves?
Yeah.
Nice
try, though. Yeah, nice try, mate. Yeah. This guy's supposed to be mediating this. Can't even get the game right, mate.
No, that's all right. I thought you guys were going to get piped up. No, I said to you.
Liverpool will grab a little 1-0, 2-1. Like, they seem to scrape these away wins at the moment. Like, they did it at Huddersfield.
Right, so the big one now, Fulham versus Southampton. Because this is Ranieri's first game.
Mate, obviously me and Darren are going. So
I'm going 3-0 Fulham.
Darren.
Oh, hey.
Hey, Darren, can you hear that?
Stop trying to get this guy's good.
He's all right now, guys. Don't worry. When he comes with me on Saturday, you've got to give him a bit of love, mate.
Darren, quick question. And obviously, I want everyone's thoughts even, because some people have been giving criticism. We didn't even talk about it on Ranieri actually coming in. Some people have been saying, okay, well, I know he won a league for Leicester, but over his 20-year career, he's done nothing else.
He's managing Fulham.
Got any respect.
With all respect to my own club.
No, of course. So I want to know people's opinion, because do you think Ranieri deserves... I think Ranieri deserves eternal respect, regardless. Do you know what I mean? Even if he doesn't do well at Fulham, he won a league for Leicester. What do you think about Ranieri? Do you think he's worth the respect that everyone gives him? Or do you think... Because people are saying it was a fluky year or a lucky year.
No, that was Chris. That was Chris who said it was a fluke.
How can you fluke 38 games?
Regardless if it was a fluke or not, he deserved the respect, because he's going to win the Premier League with Leicester. No one would ever have backed Leicester to win the Premier League. And for him to go and do that, as you said, over that amount of games, of course he deserves respect. Even if he doesn't do a single thing for the rest of his career, people will always go, wow, remember that time Leicester won the league?
It's the greatest achievement in football history.
Yeah.
If you can't give respect to a man who's done that, then you're smoking some mad food, mate.
And because of that, and everybody loves Ranieri, he's going to get a lot of backing now for this whole Fulham thing. Man. You'd be surprised. A lot of people are going to be behind
him. That's going to be my new thing.
Apparently, you guys are getting pizza or burgers?
Burgers. They say McDonald's. McDonald's.
McDonald's for rewards and that.
I think,
that's it.
Come like his blue pizza.
Yeah, had a pizza, now it's McDonald's.
Little chicken salad. 3-0 Fulham, yeah?
No, I think I've got to be realistic. I reckon like a 1-0 or 2-1. We still like, it's...
I reckon defensively he might be able to sort you guys out.
I think him coming in, first game, everyone's excited. It's at Craven Cottage. Fulham score early. Southampton are struggling as it is.
Yeah, it's true.
Exactly.
I'm trying to be like realistic, but do you know what? 2-1. We're going
to
win this.
You got to be Southampton.
We need to win these games. Mitrovic will start scoring again.
Yeah. That's what I'm worried about, because him and Jukanovic, they had a very good relationship. He's the reason why he came to Fulham. So I'm a bit worried that...
Mitrovic might sulk a bit because
I love Mitrovic. He's a great player, but he's very emotional in terms of how he, like, especially in games, he can go missing in games because if things aren't going his way, he just switches off. And I'm worried that if he's still annoyed about Jukanovic not being here, I'm worried that it's gonna affect his performance. But we'll see, man. We'll see.
Bournemouth Arsenal.
I thought you said something.
Bournemouth Arsenal.
Bournemouth Arsenal.
That's gonna be 3-3.
Oh, what, like last time? What, or say? 2 years ago?
I'm going to say
Bournemouth on form right now.
Yeah, I'm going to say 1-0.
1-0.
It'll be a tough game down there for Arsenal. Yeah,
I reckon
tough.
Arsenal will sneak a win.
It'll be close.
A little 1-0, 2-1.
If you not get a good, you reckon it'll be a lot of goals?
Yeah, a lot of goals.
I don't know.
Open-ended.
I could see it just being a real tight, like 1-1.
Like maybe a 2-1, I think. I reckon Arsenal will win it, though, just about.
I reckon Bournemouth. Like a little 2-1 for Bournemouth, I reckon. I'm not hating on that.
Final quick questions for everyone. What is the top four going to be by the 1st of January? What's the bottom three going
to
be?
If any of you lot say Fulham, I swear to God.
Because in the next six weeks, there's a lot of games. There's a lot of games.
I'll show you. Look,
you can go to the league.
I'll show you right now.
So I'll say first.
Cardiff. Done at it. Fulham still done at it.
Why is Cardiff done at it? They just won two.
Bro, I don't care if they won it.
Neil
Warnock, he's my guy, but he's done at it.
He's got the worst trim in the league. That trim is mad.
I wanted to go for Halloween, fam. It's a mad team.
No, you're thinking of me.
I'm going to say the bottom three are going to be Huddersfield, Cardiff and Southampton.
I'm saying that because
I think Fulham will beat Southampton.
Okay.
So I think, do you know what I mean?
They'll jump up.
So I told you, he's a secret Fulham fan. Deep down, he's saying he's Arsenal, but he's Fulham. I can
hey,
tell.
Listen, what you say, Man United? Can Man United creep back into the top four this season?
No.
Yeah, but not by the 1st of Jan.
not by the end of May either. Nah, top four by January. I'm going to go Man City.
Liverpool,
obviously.
Chelsea
and Tottenham. Or Arsenal. Mm. Oh, no, Arsenal. Yeah, Arsenal. Yeah, that's
so you reckon, and then you reckon Spurs and United?
No, United will be like 10th.
Still 11th. 10th for now.
Yeah.
Oh, right.
Of course, yeah.
10th for 11th.
Mourinho's, I went
to the Manchester Derby, yeah. Since then, man's still been stressed out. Yeah. We saw one guy we saw, like, he's a City fan, isn't it? Bruv, the smug, like, we're not even worth the banter no more. Yeah, like, you know what that's like? You know when you're not worth the banter, no man are like thinking, that's a bit mad for you now.
You know when they come up to you, go like, bro, I'm sorry, man. That's when you know it's rock bottom.
Like,
bro, I feel
there's not even
you can't even banter you anymore. It's just like, that's how bad it is.
So I'm not
that's
lie.
What I'm at getting moment, right now. No one's calling me anymore. Everyone's like, bro, I'm so sorry to see this, man. I'll just stay like,
hey, after this one time we finished the show here, we went to the pub in it to watch.
Oh, that was
the Huddersfield game, yeah.
Brother,
that bottom of the table trash.
It was horrible football.
It was horrible.
The slide tackles and
you see that thing I put
the shape of the back line.
You see that thing I put at GRM?
No.
I was just like Huddersfield Fulham last night. It's like blind football where
like,
no one knows where the ball is. And then the goalkeeper's just lying on the floor hoping it doesn't get hit.
We'll let you finish and we'll conclude and let the people decide who they think is going to get.
My top four is going to be, for 1st of January, it will be as it is. So Tottenham, Chelsea, Liverpool, Man City. The bottom three, I think Fulham's still going to be in there. Sorry, man.
Pagan.
Fulham, Southampton and Huddersfield. Neil
this
Warnock's
guy's
rated job.
Cardiff.
No.
guys, let us know in the comments below.
Neil Warnock's little bit on the side, mate.
Let us know in the comments below who you think the bottom three are going to be. Let's not talk about the top four. Bro, no, Darren Bent, thank you so much for
big
coming.
Big man, Darren Bent.
Big man, Darren Bent.
I like you, man.
Stand up, fella.
That's my guy now.
Stand up, fella. Yeah, thanks for coming on. Cool. All right.
Thank you very much, man.
Make sure
man.
You guys like,
that.
Share, comment, and subscribe.
Yeah, do all of that.
I'm Big J.
I'm Cheeky Sport Ack.
The wild peanut, Jake.
And this is Darren Bent. Brother, we're out, man. We're out.